Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Neighborhood Watch 2, After the EMP, by E.E. Isherwood, narrated by Kyle Tait. Chapter 1. Good morning, Frank. Luke walked up to the edge of the canal to be next to me. You enjoying your retirement so far? Oh, you're the funny guy, I laughed. I had you pegged as the town sourpuss. We shared a quiet chuckle, since it was understood my retirement ended when the EMP went off. You and your son do all right on your overnight shift? I asked. No problems at all. Turns out the job is pretty easy when you don't have a shifty neighbor like Trevor sneaking around behind your back. There were a few gunshots in the distance, but nothing close by. We also thought we heard a car drive down Bayside Road, but we couldn't be certain. Otherwise, guard duty was downright boring last night. Just how I like it. I'd gotten up early to check out the canal running parallel to our street. While there, I'd studied the backyards and rear sides of the row of houses on the next block. Since I'd recently moved in, it had been hard to get to know my immediate neighbors, which meant I knew even less about the other two streets in the Yucca Reef development. It was nice to have the canal as a buffer between us and those strangers. But it was a certainty I'd need to meet them in the near future. Finding allies was going to be one critical aspect of our survival plan. Things are going too well, I said, as I turned to face Luke. Maybe this EMP bullshit isn't going to be as bad as you thought, my upbeat neighbor suggested. Maybe, I allowed. We stood side by side watching the quiet water of the canal for a few seconds, before I continued. Yesterday started off as a white-knuckle day, but it turned out all right thanks to you and the rest of the watch. It hadn't even been 24 hours since our encounter with Trevor and the incident with Zen at the roadblock. Once Zen had taken Trevor and Pike off our hands, the neighborhood finished the roadblock by moving more vehicles into position to boost security. I then took everyone behind my house and set up a shooting range to give them some practice with firearms, including Carmen, who seemed to crave more responsibility in our defense. Finally, we'd grilled up the last of the meats and also dried out whatever didn't get eaten, so we'd have jerky in our food stocks. On paper, things were a bit better than the previous morning. Fewer gunshots, as Luke had pointed out. No visible smoke plumes. No one barreling down our street looking for trouble. We had a lot of help from you, Frank. Don't discount yourself. I would have lost my shit if I'd gone to Trevor's place without you. I also never would have thought of setting up a roadblock. And what you did for Penny... I wiped at the beads of sweat forming on the back of my neck. The sun was already heating up the thick ocean air, and apocalypse or not, the miserable heat of a June day in Florida was coming at us. Thanks, I said in a quiet voice. I've always done my best work when I had a good team around me. You've more than stepped up and done your part, and I'm grateful I found you when I did. I let my voice trail off. But, Luke prodded. Well, I hate to be the guy who dumps on a good thing. I released a long sigh. But none of my books ever suggested the world is going to get better after an EMP goes off. Last night might seem like it was better than the one before. And maybe it was. But this period of calm we're living in won't last for long. That's almost what you said when I first met you on your driveway, Luke reminded me. You warned us as the effects of an EMP go on, things will inevitably break down more. Maybe it's just taking a little longer than you thought? There was no magic formula, as best as I could recall, for how fast a community would break apart once the power grid went belly up. In the big cities, it probably happened within hours. Out in the sticks, like all those endless miles of farmland I'd passed on my way from Chicago to Fort Myers. The collapse might take days or weeks. In the middle ground between the two, like the endless subdivisions surrounding us, It was anyone's guess. You know me well enough now to understand I don't water things down, I said to Luke. And believe me when I say, I want to be wrong about this. But the rest of Fort Myers isn't going to be looking at this like you and me. People are waking up right now, looking out their windows, and wondering if they'll see the police or military coming in to rescue them. They're waking up to find the first few items turning bad in their powerless refrigerators. They're strolling out their doors, totally oblivious to how bad things are going to get. I paused briefly to make my point. We need to assume we can't rely on anyone but ourselves. I probably would have been one of those unsuspecting people if you hadn't put my head on straight. But thinking like you, I'm going to assume this shit show is only ramping up. So what do we need to do today to stay alive longer than tomorrow? You've asked the million-dollar question, I answered. I tried to formulate some thoughts based on books I'd read over the years. At the most basic level, there were three things we needed to worry about: food, water, and shelter. We had brand new houses, designed with the latest techniques to withstand those infamous Florida hurricanes. So we were good on that point. Food might have turned into a problem within a week or two, but we'd been given a helping hand by Mr. Drummond and his garage full of survival rations. Which left? Water. What's our most pressing issue? Luke wondered. I pointed toward the middle of the waterway. The canal? Not exactly. To survive long term, we're going to need clean drinking water. I thought we had it easy living next to a freshwater canal. But that is the first sign it might not be so simple. I continued to point at the object of my concern. Eventually, Luke saw it. A dead alligator! On any normal day, no resident would go out and shoot one of the lazy creatures. But normal had been shut off with the power. Someone on the next street had put a bullet into the brain pan of a good-sized 8-footer and left the body to rot in the canal. Yep, people are going to use these canals as their personal trash cans. I'd bet my last dollar we'll soon see poopy diapers floating by. And worse. Can't we filter it? You mentioned that before. In the short term, yes. But filtering is a major pain in the ass, and it gets difficult when you need larger quantities, like we'd need to maintain everyone on our block. Also, imagine a canal full of rotting bodies, like the alligator. I'm not sure I would trust any filter to clean water tainted by diseases spawned by death. I see what you mean, but every house and building in this part of Florida probably has some kind of filter attached to their plumbing, since the groundwater is so shitty. Can't we use those to clean it all up? For a while, yes. Pool shock is another chemical that can treat water to make it drinkable. And we probably have a lifetime supply with all the pools around here. But again, it's going to be hard to treat water each time we need to use it. Bacteria is going to grow in any vessel we use to store larger quantities, and we'd still need to boil the hell out of all water, especially if it comes from there. I pointed to the canal again. So we have all the stuff we need to filter our water today, but you were looking far down the road? All those filters and chemicals will scrape us by for sure, but they aren't ideal in the long term. Eventually, someone gets sloppy with the filtration, or a contaminant gets into our holding tanks we fail to boil out. Then someone dies. Not good, Luke replied. If we want to be alive a year from now in a powerless world, we need a more reliable water source, like a well. We'll also catch rainwater for where we need clean water, like for washing clothes, but it won't be good for drinking. A well, huh? That seems complicated. I laughed. People in 200 BC knew how to dig wells and get fresh water. I'm sure a group of us from the 21st century can figure it out. I'll help however I can, but I'm an IT guy, so I know nothing about wells. Are you telling me I would be better off with a guy from over 2,000 years ago? It's your call. Luke put his hands up in an I'm out of ideas pose. Trust me, you'll be fine. I've read about the basics before, though I have to admit the larger problem is finding all the parts and getting them back to our street using our bikes. We'll need some pipes, some storage barrels to catch rainwater, and a hand-operated pump for the well. I stopped my train of thought, then turned back toward the houses. Wouldn't it be funny, I continued, if Mr. Drummond had already thought of this? He'd obviously been planning for the end of the world. So let's see if he has any well equipment in his garage. Luke followed me toward the older guy's home. Don't be shocked when you see the place, I advised. Mr. Drummond has a little of everything, but I haven't really told the others yet, as I'm not sure what legal standing we have to take over another man's property. I like how you're even thinking of stuff like this. If I was gone for good, I'd be glad someone could get some use out of my things. There's the problem. Mr. and Mrs. Drummond left on a vacation to Europe at some point, and I'm trying to keep this stockpile under wraps until I can be reasonably sure they're gone for good. The less people who knew about it, the better. Trevor had been in Mr. Drummond's place already, but I had no idea how much of the garage he'd managed to see. I needed to assume he would give up every bit of information about our street when trying to convince Zen of his own importance. I understand. Luke followed me through the damaged front door, trailed me into the kitchen, and then stepped out into the dim garage.
Holy shit! Luke exclaimed.
He walked around like a kid who'd been given an unlimited credit card for the Lego store.
He has more food than I've ever seen in one house. And over here he has pallets of bottled waters. But what are we looking for exactly?
Long pipes? A sledgehammer? Valves? There will definitely be a well pump handle to get the water to the surface.
Got it, he replied.
We both picked through the stockpile, but I knew in minutes there wasn't anything as obvious as pipes or pumps lying around.
What do you think he's got under here?
Luke asked after we'd looked over most of the garage. He stood close to the vehicle packed into the third bay of the garage. It's the only place we haven't searched for well-making supplies, so I hope he has one stashed under there. But it is more likely the old guy packed away a Jaguar or Mercedes. Drummond's other vehicle was a fully trimmed-out Cadillac Escalade, so I knew he had money.
You mind?
Luke asked with anticipation as he took hold of the blue cloth. Be my guest. Luke yanked the drop cloth as fast as he could, and tufts of dust billowed up with it.
Damn, he hasn't been under there for years, I choked.
Luke drew back the cover until it revealed a classic hot rod.
Son of a bitch, I said, impressed. This is way better than a Mercedes. It looks nice, but what does it get us?
Luke asked in a measured tone.
We've got one more truck for the roadblock, right?
I sidled up to the 1970 Chevrolet El Camino SS. It was painted deep blue, with accent flecks of metal that sparkled, despite the darkened garage. Two bright white stripes, each about 12 inches wide, ran lengthwise down the middle of the hood. It also had perfect chrome trim, bumpers, custom wheels, and a chrome Supersport logo in the middle of the front grille. The vintage truck came with a long bed for storage, much like any pickup truck of the day. But the front half looked more like a sports car than a work vehicle. The odd style is what made them so collectible.
This gets us our well, I answered with respect. How?
I leaned over and felt the edge of the body, as if admiring the curves of a beautiful woman.
I'll pop the hood, and you'll see what American engines looked like before there were computer chips in them. This old workhorse wouldn't even have noticed the EMP, so I'll bet we can drive this right out of here, if Drummond took care of it like he did with everything else. I pulled off the hood pins and toggled the hood release above the front license plate to spring it open. I couldn't deny it reminded me of the anticipation of opening 1,000 hoods over my lifetime. There was a sense of magic when learning what was under there. I pushed the hood all the way, so it stayed propped open. "Now that's what I'm talking about," I gushed. The painters had been meticulous about covering the engine bay with the same coating as the rest of the truck. The V8 had many custom parts, some chrome, some blacked out. But all of them looked to be well manufactured. And most importantly, none of them were electronic. The round air cleaner housing sat in the middle, with a red 454 stenciled on the top, and the black paint could be mistaken for brand new, as if it had been purchased from the original factory and sent forward in time to Drummond's garage. Every item under the hood dripped with quality and durability, which were two big pluses during an apocalypse. Someone had written 475 horsepower custom on bare paint near the front, as if to brag about it. "This is an incredible find," I went on. "I really can't believe it."
"Yeah, lucky us," Luke agreed. "Especially if it fires up."
I noticed the oil cap was unscrewed. It sat in its spot, but it wasn't tightened, as if it had been left there on purpose.
"See if it will crank over," Luke suggested.
"Hang on a second," I replied while looking under the vehicle.
"I think we have a problem."
A small jack propped up the underside of the frame enough for me to squeeze in. A round pan was underneath the car, filled halfway with black liquid, and the oil plug had been set on a rag next to the container. It explained why Drummond had never sealed the cap on top of the engine. It might have been a minor inconvenience for me to put it all back together, but the oil filter was missing.
"Yep," I continued. "I'm glad we didn't fire it up with all this going on under here. There's no oil in the crankcase right now. Look around up there and see if Drummond had purchased a new oil filter back when he started this project. It will be in packaging about the size of a Pop-Tarts box." After a couple minutes of searching, Luke got my attention by tapping my foot.
"Sorry, Frank. I don't see it anywhere."
I slid out from under the El Camino and glanced around the garage to see if I'd see the familiar branding and size of the filter. But I wasn't rewarded with a discovery.
"Shit," I exclaimed. "Drummond has the perfect vehicle for our needs, but he's missing one of the easiest things to replace on an engine. We can't go to the end of the driveway without that filter."
"Can we swap one from any of the cars out on the street?" Luke asked.
"I doubt it," I said after imagining the makes and models of most of the cars on our street.
Since I'd worked with all the vehicles at the roadblock, I knew the available inventory much as a used car salesman might.
"This is a 1970 big block 454 Chevy motor. If I remember right, this thing came stock with 450 horsepower, and it was highly sought after by my gearhead friends because it was rare back in the day. I can say with certainty none of the vehicles on our street have the same engine, even in its modern form. I don't know cars well enough to predict if another oil filter would be close to a fit, but I never heard of a mechanic mixing and matching filters with any of my semi-trucks.
I guess it would get pretty messy out there if we tried to pull filters off the other cars, just to try."
"Well, we could catch most of the oil," I chuckled, "but it would still be messy, and it would take a lot of time. If we want clean water, we need to get this running before our quiet morning takes a turn for the worse."
I ran my fingers along the chrome work at the edge of the front bumper, which led me to find what was sitting by the jack.
"It looks like he has a foot pump, too," I continued, "so we don't have to use one of your little bike pumps."
"That would suck," he agreed.
I headed for the kitchen door.
"So what's the plan?" Luke asked. "Let's go grab our bikes," I replied. "We can pop into Auto Country to get a replacement oil filter."
"And then we go for a car ride?" Luke suggested.
"Yep. we'll go out there the way God intended, with 475 horsepower under our butts. Books often mention the danger of having one of the only working vehicles in a powerless world. It would almost certainly make us into a bullseye target for criminals and the desperate. 475 horsepower would help us stay in front of many problems, though not bullets, roadblocks, and other hot rods. However, I didn't want to put those worries into Luke's head. Yet. It was a problem for later in the day. First, we had to venture into the world on a one-human-powered bicycle. Chapter 2. We gathered in my garage. "Welcome to the first official meeting of our neighborhood watch," I said. Glad to be around people who were motivated to be there, same as me.
"You said this was important, so we all showed up," Carmen replied with a wide grin.
Unlike the previous couple of days, she was now dressed in an outfit a little more appropriate for the apocalypse. Her denim jeans were loose-fitting and comfortable, as was her long-sleeve top. Her entire outfit was built around the centerpiece, Rocco, the Ruger LCR, the small black revolver strapped on her left hip. The others gave me similar short greetings.
"It looks like we're all here, except the kids up at the roadblock."
Everyone currently available from our street was in my garage, except for Tyler, Rainey, and the twins. They were assigned the task of manning the roadblock. The group of teens were already famous for chit-chatting and arguing, but they'd done great work moving the cars, so I'd put a little more trust in them in the new day. No one could coast in the apocalypse.
"Just let them know what we talk about after we break," I suggested.
"We'll tell them," LeVar replied.
The tall black man stood next to his much shorter wife, holding hands, obviously happy to be back together.
"Thanks," I saluted.
Luke and I had left Drummond's garage about 20 minutes earlier. While Luke gathered our neighbors, I'd gone into my house to gather a few items we'd need for the meeting. The books stacked neatly on my 6-foot folding table were the result of my efforts.
"We've been lucky so far. This EMP event hasn't spiraled into hell on earth in the first 24 hours. Many of these books I've brought out will have you believe it's a possibility once the power goes out. And maybe it is in the larger cities, but we've been spared that fate for now. Earlier, Luke and I were discussing how last night seemed quieter than the one before, almost like people decided they didn't want to jump off the cliff of chaos so soon. But I looked out toward the teenagers. I'm kind of glad those kids aren't here, because we have some hard truths we need to discuss. I glanced over to Penny and little Daisy, who was too young to be left alone for very long. The youngster stood between her mother and Carmen, almost as if the two women had joined forces to protect the little one. It bothered me to have to speak bluntly in front of the kid, but she was so young I hoped it would go right over her curly blonde head. "First, if the power doesn't come back on today, and we don't hear a word from anyone in charge, I think it will confirm things are going to continue down this path for a long time. Weeks for certain. Months, probably. Maybe even years."
Evelyn, standing way at the back, harrumphed. I was not surprised. For once, I would have loved to see the grumpy woman be right.
"We've done some great work together. The roadblock is looking fantastic. We've flooded our homes with extra water. The kids managed to pull a few fish out of the canal last night, proving we can gather a little extra food. You all did great during our shooting practice. We all worked together to clear out Trevor and his friends."
On paper, getting rid of the wild kid was mainly due to me and Luke, plus Carmen keeping guard. But everyone had played a role. The other adults had kept the kids safe in my garage, and they'd come out in force to make sure Zen knew the street was supported by a proper defense. I figured it was better to share the glory of victory than to divide it into little bits.
"But there is still a shitload of things we still need to do,
and we should start with those that will have the biggest long-term impact for us.
I saw some confused faces.
I've read stories about psycho bikers, cannibals, bad governments, and invasions of locusts, and we should think about them. But those aren't even close to our biggest threats. Our worst enemy will be filth, today, tomorrow, and each day going forward. It may not be sexy to talk about, but finding clean water will probably be our biggest struggle. You understand?
I looked around the room, and they nodded.
We have plenty of stored water around us, including Trevor's swimming pool, our bathtubs, plus the canal. However, those things will soon be contaminated with bacteria, germs, and trash. We can, of course, treat all of them with chemicals and boiling, but it would be a ton of work over the long haul. So to get around all that useless labor, I believe we should dig a well.
Work now, relax later, Ben said dryly.
Yes and no, I answered. While other people are burning wood to boil and purify water, we'll be pumping clean water from below our feet, with no effort. That will free up our time so we can work smarter to out-prepare everyone else. We can be perfecting our defenses, scrounging food, planting crops, and 100 other things to keep us ahead of the competition.
Looking way down the road, I knew each street and each subdivision would eventually come into conflict with those around it. It would be inevitable, with so many people in South Florida packed into such a small area.
Okay, it sounds logical, Ben replied. But why is this the first thing we need to do? Shouldn't we work on putting up a barrier around the sides of our street by the woods? You said it yourself, we'll need eyes in every direction to keep ourselves safe. That seems more urgent than going out for parts to dig and maintain a well.
We need to do both at the same time, I'm afraid. And we have to start now. This might be our last chance to get into town before everything falls apart.
Ben seemed to chew on it.
Won't it be heavy, Frank?
Carmen asked.
It won't fit on a bike, will it?
We have something better than a bike, I said with a smirk.
What?
She asked with greater interest. I looked around, wondering if any of my neighbors would betray my trust on what I was about to tell them. They'd all interacted with me in one way or another, and for the most part, I decided to have faith in them. Even Evelyn, who was the town downer, didn't seem like the type of person who would stab anyone in the back. In the end, I put my money on telling them the truth. The other night I told you Trevor had broken into the Drummond place, which was how I ended up going inside the house. It was dumb luck that I also learned what the old guy and his wife had been keeping in there. Until now I didn't want to share this with the group, since I've been wrestling with the morality of poking around in another man's property.
What did you find?
Penny asked right away. The pretty mom wore black yoga shorts and a loose-fitting t-shirt, commemorating a half-marathon run in Tampa. I knew she was fit enough to rock those biker shorts the other day, but she now confirmed she could rock any piece of clothing. Still, as I needed to keep reminding myself, now wasn't the time.
Mr. Drummond and his wife went to Europe, I replied. At this point, I have to assume they are stuck there, since they haven't come back. It's important you know this, since his garage is stacked with months' worth of canned goods and sealed food containers.
I paused to let the statement sink in.
Enough for all of us? Penny wondered.
Sure, I answered. As long as we keep it hidden and protect it, his supply would provide a very nice supplement to the food all of us already have.
You don't sound happy, Penny mused.
I'm coming around on this. I smiled at her. At first, I was troubled by the fact it doesn't belong to us. But the harsh reality is we may need to tap into his reserves in order to keep ourselves alive. We'll defend it as long as we can, but
we avoid the legal and moral problems by saving his supplies for last, Ben summarized.
Yes, I answered. I think any reasonable person would agree we're doing him a favor by keeping watch on what belongs to him.
But if it comes down to us dying of starvation next to a huge pile of food, or living another day, I know which one we're picking.
Everyone shared a bit of laughter.
Makes sense, Carmen added.
I again looked at Daisy, wondering if she understood the gravity of our discussion, wondering if she knew how good she had it. She would have no idea how sideways the world was about to go.
So the thing we found that's better than a bike, I continued, is Drummond also hid an El Camino in his garage. It's an old muscle car built before computer chips, so we can get it to work. It looks like it's only missing an oil filter, so once we grab one, we're good to go.
So he wasn't as prepared as he thought, Carmen suggested.
No one's perfect, I chuckled. For all his preparations, it appears as if Mr. Drummond dropped the ball on his bug-out vehicle. It's been under a tarp for a long time, too, as if he'd forgotten the car was missing the filter. Whatever the reason, Luke and I are going to ride bikes up to the auto parts store, grab a new filter, then get back here to start it up. Once we fix it, we can use the car to haul our asses over to the hardware store and get the stuff for the well.
Penny and Carmen both seemed agreeable to the proposal, as did LeVar and Kyra. Luke was already on board, and his wife Melanie stood close by, nodding. That left Ben and Evelyn in the cheap seats.
What do you think, Ben? I prodded.
Ben took his time before responding.
It would be nice to get into town before everyone else, and having a vehicle will give us a huge advantage over most people. But I'm assuming we can't all pile in with you, so shouldn't the rest of us keep working on things here on the street?
You read my mind, I smiled as I called everyone's attention to the books on the table. Does anyone like to read? It's a long shot, but I'm hoping these books have some mentions of digging wells and setting up rainwater collection systems. I can probably do fine based on what I remember, but having exact numbers always helps.
Daisy and I love to read, Penny said as she stepped closer. We'd love to help out. Mr. Frank is giving us books? Daisy said with surprise. He sure is, dear, her mother responded. Yippee! The girl cheered. Thank you.
Penny winked at me.
We'll see how happy she is when we crack into one.
I smiled at them both.
Enjoy.
I can also help read, Evelyn added. Give me whatever she doesn't take, and I'll check them out. And I'll see if any of the kids want to help out, Melanie continued. Tyler is a big reader.
I stood back and took in my good fortune. Not only had I gotten those books the day of the EMP, I'd found readers willing to speed up the accumulation of knowledge within our group. It was hard to imagine a better outcome, all things considered.
All right, meeting adjourned, I announced.
As some of them grabbed for the books, others headed out of the garage.
Oh shit, I almost forgot, I yelled. Come on back for a second. I need to give out assignments.
Some good-natured groans came my way.
Don't worry, this is all fun stuff, I joked.
I'd been preparing a mental list of important tasks since the previous night, but since I was going to be out, I needed to delegate them to the others.
LeVar and Kyra, why don't you two go relieve the kids at the roadblock? Send them back to read books and go fishing.
On it,
the guy answered.
Carmen, I'd like you to go around to all the houses and work with the owners to secure their back doors, like you and I did at your place. Move furniture, block exits so no one can break in, that sort of thing. Sound doable?
She bit her lip before speaking.
I'll try, but don't you want to do it yourself, so you know it's done right? I'd feel terrible if someone broke in because I did things the wrong way.
You know those commercials where they say this is not financial advice? Well, this is a lot like those. Do the best you can, like me, and none of us are going to hold it against you if it isn't perfect.
Her smile grew.
I'll do my best, for you.
I'll pop in and check on your work when I can, if you'd like.
Oh, I'd like that, she purred.
I didn't let myself become distracted by her flirtatious behavior. Instead, I turned my attention to the young mother. Penny, while you're reading, would you mind hanging out on your back patio with Evelyn or some of the teens? I want to have eyes on the woods on that corner of the block so we don't get surprised, you know? She nodded. And Ben, you want a book? I held one up and grinned at the man.
Nah, I've never been much of a reader.
Good, I deadpanned. I need you for something else. I pulled the man aside and spoke in a quiet tone. I'd like you to go over to Mr. Drummond's place and inventory every usable resource in his garage. We need to know everything he has.
In case he gets robbed, he finished.
Yeah. I grimaced at the thought of more robberies. But we also need to know what he has in there when we really need it. Just like I had everyone take inventory of all their useful stuff, we need to do the same for the Drummonds. He shrugged.
I'll do it, but
why me, boss? Shouldn't I be out on the roadblock with a gun or doing more to protect ourselves from the woods? I could get any of the others to do this, but I picked you specifically because your age and experience will allow you to quickly know what's valuable and what's not. I'm going to count on you to remember it, too, in case I need to ask you in an emergency. In essence, I'm making you the gatekeeper of our missing neighbor's supplies. If you're okay with that? He was also closest in age to the missing couple. If by some miracle Mr. and Mrs. Drummond returned home, I'd much rather have an older gentleman standing in front of the survival stash rather than a young kid, since he'll look less like a potential thief.
Count me in, he agreed. But I can go back to the wall as soon as I'm done?
Definitely, I answered, and we separated. Luke and I used the chaos of the breaking meeting to head over to the bikes, which were secured in Luke's garage. We were immediately greeted by a rambunctious German shepherd who'd been lying in an open kennel. He ran by his owner and hopped on his hind legs to greet me.
Whoa, I cracked up. This is Mr. Puppers, Luke said with great pride.
What a good-looking dog, I said, scratching the excitable creature behind both ears.
He's our third baby for sure, he replied. I can get him down if you want.
I continued to play with the animal, who enjoyed every bit of the attention. Luke told me a few times he and Melanie were keeping the dog inside and out of all the commotion, so it wouldn't become a distraction. But I knew they couldn't keep that up forever. It probably thrived on being useful.
No, he's fine. In fact, we should get him familiar with all of us, so he knows we're part of his pack now.
Really? You want him around?
Hell yeah, I do.
Does he bark at strangers?
Everyone is a stranger since we moved into this new house. But he barked at the mailman at our old place, too, and we saw him every day for a full year.
I finally let Mr. Puppers fall to all fours.
He knows possible threats, I chuckled.
We'd be happy to let him roam, if you think he won't get in the way.
The dog stood looking up at me, with one ear folded down and the other sticking straight up.
His big brown eyes were asking me to approve his work release from his household prison.
He'll have to earn his keep like everyone else, but I think an early warning system is exactly what this place needs.
I'd planned to get a dog once I'd settled into my new home and built a fence, but the EMP had closed the curtains on that. I gave him a final neck scratch before pulling out the bike. We checked our weapons, put water in our packs, said goodbye to Melanie, then pedaled out onto the street. With his new freedom, Mr. Puppers ran out of the garage, followed us down the driveway, then stopped at the edge of Luke's lawn.
Stay! Luke called back.
We reached the roadblock in moments. Tyler and the other teens were still there.
Hello, Rainey waved. You let Mr. P out? That's great.
We finally did, Luke replied. Halt! Who goes there?
Tyler added as we stopped. The young girl whipped her head toward her brother.
You only asked the people coming from the outside. Sheesh, you were dumb.
Never mind her, good squires, Tyler said without missing a beat. Please doeth state yon business.
Well met, Sir Guard, I chuckled as I played along. We two men intend to ride our metal horses to a distant land known as Auto Country. We expect it to take not more than 2 ticks of a sundial before we return to yonder castle.
Rainey shook her head in mock disgust, but there was also a hint of a smile. Both of the twins were giggling at Tyler.
Then proceed forthwith to the land of serpents, the boy crowed.
Quieter, he added, we can move your corvette if you want, but I think you can squeeze your bikes between the cars.
There's room, yeah, I assured the kid.
Without prompting, Tyler slid himself between the backside of my vet and the front side of Ben's Subaru wagon. Me and Luke rolled our bikes behind him. Tyler took several quick steps forward, and then froze in place mid-stride. I looked around, wondering if the kid saw a threat. Was Zen back? Trevor? I gripped the sling of my Bravo Company AR, ready to pull it off my back.
What is it, kid? I whispered,
and the boy made a sound of huge relief.
Oh, Ty, don't tell me, Luke said with disgust.
Yeah,
Tyler said as he turned around. I really needed to get away from those girls so I could do a controlled burn.
A what?
I said flatly.
You know, when you have to let one rip, but you don't want to crap your pants in front of a girl. You have to get some distance, then slowly let it out so it doesn't become a code brown. It's something my dad taught me. The worst case scenario happened to him one time.
Tyler stood there with the pride of a kid who'd won the 4-H Fattest Pig Award. It took me a few seconds to downshift my brain from the survival setting to one closer to the gutter. Once there, I decided to hold back laughter and glared at Luke for maximum effect. Luke's cheeks flared red with embarrassment.
I'm sorry, Frank.
He turned to his son and spoke in a stern tone. We need to have a talk later about respect and timing. This isn't appropriate for the situation.
Sorry.
Tyler sheepishly looked over the cars to the twins.
I thought the situation was life or death for me.
I kept myself from bursting out laughing. I hadn't known how much I'd needed a good laugh, but I really wanted to see Luke sweat, so I kept up the image of a shocked adult.
We have to go, Luke insisted. Tyler, you go back with the girls.
My pleasure, the kid replied. Now that I'm safe.
Tyler hustled back through the roadblock while Luke and I got to pedaling.
Bring us back treasures from the faraway land,
Tyler said to our backsides, as if he hadn't gotten scolded a few seconds ago.
A gun that doth shoot big booms would be most appreciated.
The boy was hamming it up to impress the ladies. I'll see what I can do, I allowed. A minute later, as we rounded the corner and headed right onto Poseidon Pier, I let out the laughter I'd bottled up.
What's so funny? Luke asked with a puzzled look on his face.
Your boy, I guffawed. He's a real comedian, isn't he?
Luke narrowed his eyes.
You were messing with me, weren't you?
I nodded with enthusiasm. My friend relaxed and laughed a little bit, too.
I can't deny, though. I'm really interested in learning about the time you had the worst-case scenario happen to you, I chuckled. Tyler was doing all he could to avoid your fate, wasn't he?
Maybe some other time.
Luke rolled his eyes.
I'm already worried I'm going to do something dumb out here. I don't need to tell you my worst story, so you'll doubt if I'm up to this.
All right, for now. But there is no way you aren't going to tell me at some point. I'll ask Tyler if I have to.
I spoke in a glib manner, so Luke knew I wasn't serious.
He is a real piece of work, though, Luke mused.
No doubt, I agreed,
reluctantly setting the dial of my brain from humorous gutter back to deadly survivalist. I glanced back to Clownfish Cove one last time. LeVar and Kyra were already at the roadblock, changing shifts with the teens.
I also peered toward the other two streets in our neighborhood as I chased after Luke. In a perfect world, I would already know the important homeowners on each block who were the leaders. Then I could inform them I was leaving for a time and ask if they could keep an eye on our people for us. However, there hadn't been a free moment to get it done. I didn't want to send anyone else to talk to them either, since the first contact could determine the trajectory of our relationship long into the future. It didn't have to be me alone, but I wanted to be there as part of the meet and greet. It left me with another dilemma. With Luke and me gone, it created a shortfall in manpower back on our street. Was there anything I could do to counteract that? We rode for a short distance before I came up with a simple solution. "I need to take us on a little detour," I said as we came up next to the sign with a big orange fish. "That way." I pointed to a street entrance on the other side of the main road. "Are you still messing with me?" Luke asked. "What's over there?" "I'm not messing with you anymore," I answered. "And it's not what, but who." "Okay, so who's over there?" Luke asked. "I'd make it a surprise, but this is the apocalypse, and I want you to know exactly what's coming." "I appreciate it, Frank. I didn't have high blood pressure before this, but I bet I do now. A disgusting sun I can take, but a real surprise is the last thing I need." Luke followed me as we biked across the two empty lanes. I observed a few walkers moving up and down the road in both directions, but it appeared mostly calm. "We're going to pay a visit to Zen to see if he'd be willing to guard the front of our subdivision." "Yeah, that would have been a real shock if you hadn't told me." "Why him?" "If this is as bad as I fear, we'll need real allies we can depend on. Zen said we'd watch out for each other, so it's time to put our alliance to the test." We rolled on for a few moments. "You know I'm with you, Frank, but it sounds risky." "I agree completely. But here's the thing I didn't tell the others. Everything we do from here on out is going to come with a degree of risk. Stubbing a toe can lead to infection. Water will be teeming with germs. Every new person could shoot us in the face to get our toilet paper. Risks are unavoidable now, but we can mitigate those risks by choosing when to face them. I'd rather do this now, while we are healthy and strong, than down the road when we are hungry and exhausted and not thinking clearly." "That I can understand." We rode for a couple minutes until reaching a side street off the main thoroughway for the subdivision. Zen had given me a basic area of where he lived and the name of his street, so I hoped to find... "There!" I exclaimed. Ahead, exactly as I'd done on Clownfish Cove, Zen and his gang sat around a line of cars blocking the far end of their quarter mile of subdivision street. We stopped well short of the barricade. "Ahoy!" I shouted. "It's Frank Douglas from yesterday." Zen squinted for a few seconds, then waved us over. Luke and I carried a rifle and shotgun, but kept them slung over our shoulders. It was the same dance I'd made Zen and his guys do the day before.
"Frank, welcome," Zen said as he came out from the blockade.
Since we were familiar with each other, it seemed an okay thing to do. I wasn't sure if I'd have trusted Zen if our roles were reversed, though it was part of why I was making the effort to meet him, to build trust.
"To what do I owe the honor? You haven't come to get Trevor back, have you?"
"Hell no," I replied, as we closed the distance while on foot.
"Right on. He's not here anymore."
He flung his long hair over his shoulder, as it was out of his ponytail.
"We sent him to some dudes in another neighborhood. My boss, if you catch my drift. I wanted to scare the balls off him before I decided what to do with him."
I had no interest in what happened within drug-dealing gangs, as long as the end result was no Trevor to worry about.
"He's not my concern today. I came here to see if you could help me out and post a couple of guards at the head of my street while me and my friends go into town to get supplies."
"Oh? What kind of supplies?" There was no point in lying to the guy, building trust and all.
My goal for today is to get the parts necessary to build a well. If I can get a well plugged in, we'll have clean water pretty much forever. Then we won't have to deal with boiling, purification, or stuff like that.
Zen seemed to be in his head as he thought about my claim. His AK-47 underfolder was on a sling, which placed it directly on his chest. He absentmindedly patted it until he returned his attention.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.